In this video, I want to specifically talk about the interesting backdoor technique that was used in the Acoraida Monica smart contract, which was a CTF challenge from the real-world CTF finals. I've already created two videos where I go over my attempts at solving the challenge and then eventually walk through the solution. However, I did not properly explain how the contract was actually backdoored, partially because I didn't fully understand it. At some point I thought the bytecode was actually modified and the solidity code was just fake, but I asked the challenge creator again and he said that he didn't modify the bytecode at all. So I was talking with Jesse from Perfect Blue about the challenge and more specifically that backdoor, and eventually we figured out how it works. So as you know, the constructor of the Acoraida Monica contract had this inline assembly where it takes the current program counter value, adds this constant byte on it and then jumps there. So it will leave the constructor here and jump away. In the videos we already looked at the code where it jumps to and saw that it stores a value in storage, but we ignored those values pushed on the stack and the return. Let me quickly show you how a contract is deployed on the Ethereum blockchain. The constructor just takes a number and sets this variable, and we have a test function. Let's enter some recognizable characters as numbers. Those are hex values for AAA, BBB, CCCC. Then deploy it. Now we can click on debug and use the remix debugger to check out what the Ethereum VM executes to deploy this contract. I'm quickly stepping through looking for where we perform this assignment. Ah, here's the S store, storage store. So this takes the first value of the stack as a key and then the second value of the stack is the value. If we pay attention to the storage down here and we execute the S store, we can see that the two stack items are consumed and now we have one key value pair in storage. And storage persists in the contract. So now this is set. But let's start over again and instead look at how our parameters come to the stack in the first place. Keep an eye on the memory and wait for the parameter to appear. There it is. If we look at the instruction that put this value into memory, we see that was a code copy. Code copy copies data from the code into memory. In the Ethereum VM, the code is separate from memory. And on the stack, you can see that it copies hex to 0, so 32 bytes, from the code at offset hex 15e to memory at offset hex 80. Our code is the call data down here, which is the input in the Ethereum transaction. And this is our code. Here is where the Ethereum VM started executing, and you can see that the Solidity compiler placed our parameter for the constructor at the end. And this call copy will copy now the parameter into memory so that the following code can then take it and put it onto the stack and eventually commit it to storage. Now that the constructor is done, it will push some more values on the stack, perform another code copy, and if you observe the memory, you see that it now copied what looks like code into memory at offset 0. But not all the code. If you look carefully, it's from here. The code before is actually what we are executing right now. It performs all this code copy, the constructor code, and now it deploys the actual contract code. And it does this by simply loading the actual contract code into memory and then doing a return. This return instruction wants two values on the stack, a memory offset and size. This will tell the Ethereum blockchain my contract code starts at 0 and is hex 12A long. Now this code from memory becomes our actual real contract code. Let's summarize how a contract creation from Solidity compiled contracts works. We have a big chunk of code that contains deployment and constructor code and the real contract code. Then we execute the first code, which will first load parameters into memory, then execute the constructor code, which for example in our case set the storage for that number variable. Then we load the actual contract code into memory, which will then be deployed as a contract code once we return with the value defining that memory range. So if we really understand this, we can also now abuse this to inject malicious backdoored code into a carefully prepared contract. So here's a small example contract that is supposed to be good. It has a test function that returns the string good and has a constructor like the original Acoraida Monica one. So here I just jump to hard-coded address somewhere in code. But our goal is to actually deploy this evil contract. So let's first compile the evil contract and get the code of it. To do that, we simply deploy it and then use debug again to step through the contract creation until we reach the return instruction, because this is where we can get the evil contract code. I have to clean it up a bit to get a proper hex string of the bytecode, but that goes quick. Here we go. But before we can inject the code into the good contract, let's see how that byte parameter behaves in general. Let's again use a recognizable hex number and pass it in as the good contract's constructor parameter. If we try to deploy that, then it will fail. That was expected. If we debug this and just quickly step through the trace, we see that it reaches this push 6b and the jump. Exactly our constructor code. And of course, that will jump right now into something bad. So the Ethereum VM just failed. But more important for us right now is that if we backtrack a little bit the execution trace, we can find the first code copy, which copied the byte parameter into memory. So here is our parameter in the code. If we count the bytes beforehand, we can find the offset where our parameter starts, and maybe you guessed it already. The 6b is this offset. So jumping to 6b will jump right at the start of our parameter. So here we can write now our arbitrary code. So all we have to do is to make sure we have a jump test at the start of our parameter so we can jump here. And then we have to prepare the stack so that the return instruction deploys this evil code instead. So the size of our evil code is hex 1 to A, and we can see that our parameter starts at hex C0 in memory. But of course, at the start, we will have this code snippet we are writing right now, so we need to specify the offset right behind us where the evil contract code starts. So counting that would be C7, because we also need the return instruction. Cool. And then return is F3. Let's try it. Let's put it all into a nice byte string and try to deploy the good contract with this parameter. And it succeeded. We deployed something. Let's have a look at the debug. Here's the first code copy, so this copies our parameter. And as you can see at C0, our small snippet starts, and at C7 is then the actual evil contract code. Let's continue and try to find the constructor jump. Push 6b, jump. Boom, we landed our jump test. Now we push the code size, hex 12a, and push where the code in memory starts, C7. So it deploys code from C7 that is 12a bytes long. So this should have deployed our evil contract code instead. Let's try it. Let's try to call the test function on the supposedly good contract. Transaction successful. Let's look at the output. And here it is. This call to test returned evil, even though we deployed a good contract that should return good. So crazy. It sounds really simple if you explain it like that, but dang, until we figured that out, that took so many hours. Anyway, if that was intriguing to you, I can really recommend the two videos I made about the whole Acoraida Monica challenge, because there are a lot more crazy things going on.